We will now get started with tonight's program. My name is Or Purat, and I'm a postdoctoral researcher and instructor in the Department of East Asian Languages and Civilizations at the University of Chicago. I am thrilled to bring this series to you as we welcome tonight's guest speaker, Dr. Emily B. Simpson with Dartmouth College, who will discuss Cooling the Womb of Stone, Empress Jingū and Embodied Pregnancy in Late Medieval Origin Stories. This series of lectures, taking place Monday evenings during the month of May, investigates the role of the body in the East Asian imaginaire and how it has been configured in religious, historical, and cultural contexts from the medieval period to the modern era. While tonight's lecture is the final lecture of the series, if you are interested in viewing previous lectures that have been authorized for recording, please visit the link on the CEAS website, which will direct you to the series webpage, or visit the CEAS YouTube channel, where the videos will be uploaded for public viewing. These links will be made available in the chat box. This series and tonight's event is sponsored by the Center for East Asian Studies at the University of Chicago, otherwise known as CEAS, as I mentioned earlier. CEAS is an interdisciplinary nexus clearinghouse and resource for academic exploration and support related to the study of China, Japan, and Korea. For more information on CEAS and to subscribe to receive weekly outreach emails pertaining to future events sponsored by the center, please click on the links that will be provided right now in the chat box. Now, before I introduce tonight's speaker, I would like to remind everyone about tonight's Q&A session that will follow tonight's presentation. To ask a question, please be sure to type in your questions into the Q&A box. So I will now introduce formally our distinguished guest, Dr. Emily B. Simpson, who received her PhD from the University of California at Santa Barbara in 2019, is now a lecturer at Dartmouth College. Her research centers on the legend of Empress Jingū, a third century shaman, empress and conqueror appearing in early Japanese chronicles. Simpson pays particular attention to the medieval reinterpretations of Jingu's legend within various Buddhist and Shinto traditions and their subsequent impact on the formation of women's cults centered on the empress. Her book project entitled Crafting a Goddess, Divinization and Womanhood in Late Medieval and Early Modern Narratives of Empress Jingū explores how diverse religious institutions divinized Empress Jingū, focusing on her martial and shamanic deeds, her motherhood and childbirth, or her connections to maritime deities and communities. So welcome, Dr. Simpson.
Thank you so much, Dr. Porat, for that generous introduction, as well as for organizing this series. I've really enjoyed watching the other talks that have preceded mine. And I also want to thank Connie and Myra at CAAS for all of their help. And I thank you all for attending. I look forward to your questions afterwards. All right, so my talk is entitled, as Dr. Porat mentioned, Cooling the Womb of Stone, Empress Jingū and Embodied Pregnancy in Late Medieval Origin Stories. So let's talk a little bit about Empress Jingū. As Dr. Porat mentioned, my work does center on Empress Jingū and her divinization within various texts and groups within Japan. Empress Jingū is most famous for her legendary conquest of the Korean peninsula, and she's said to have lived from 169 to 269. Much of the work on Empress Jingū has centered on whether or not she actually lived, which is not really my interest here, but just to note that if she did exist, it's thought to have been a bit later, likely the fourth century. In addition to conquering the Korean peninsula, she returned home, gave birth to a son, and yet ruled for 69 years as a regent. So in many texts, she's considered the first empress, for the first reigning empress in Japan. The first texts she's recorded in are the very first texts we have in Japanese, the Kojiki and Nihon Shoki, early, compilations of myth and history related to the imperial family of Japan. But what I'm really going to be focusing on today is sort of her medieval stories, really, as we see here in a lot of narratives related to specific shrine temple complexes in Japan. And by that time, her son, Emperor Ōjin, was firmly identified with the deity Hachiman, who really was quite a prominent deity in a lot of different fields. So that's, again, most of what I'll be talking about today. But Jingū herself was deified partially alongside Hachiman, but also alongside other prominent gods such as Sumiyoshi and Okuninushi. So in terms of, sort of her realms of influence, shall we say, she's deified as a goddess of war, sea, motherhood, and childbirth. And it's the latter two that I'll really be focusing on today. So the Hachiman cult grew in popularity after the Mongol invasions of Japan, partially because Hachiman was thought to have helped dispel these invasions by use of divine winds, really typhoons, that destroyed a good portion of the Mongol fleet. And thus, in the wake of the invasions, we find that a lot of different shrine temple complexes are authoring origin narratives, jisha engi, a very prominent genre authored by shrine temple complexes. And Jingū features particularly strongly in these stories, likely because Jingū is pregnant with Ōjin, who is identified as Hachiman. So it's a way to bring Hachiman into the conquest story. But in addition to discussing the conquest of the Korean peninsula, these narratives of Jingū's conquest, particularly at this period, really focus on Jingū's body, which is why I get to join this series. And in particular, they really are looking at her, her pregnancy, her childbirth, and motherhood as sort of key themes that, of course, not only focus on Jingū, but on her son Hachiman. And really, it's Hachiman's presence in her womb that we have to keep in mind as sort of the raison d'etre for these particular narratives. So let me get started. I have a few different themes to go through in which I'll show you a lot of the sort of exciting passages from these particular texts. I'm really looking at sort of the most major Hachiman origin stories from the late medieval period. And then we'll, I'll sort of draw out certain themes from each of them. So we'll start out with Jingū's gendered body. I'd like to start out with one of my favorite passages from one of my favorite texts, the Hachiman Gudokun, which was authored by the major Hachiman complex Iwashimizu outside Kyoto. And this is not how the text starts, but it's again a particularly vibrant passage that depicts the Empress having prepared and on her way to go to the conquest. So she was already proceeding to the enemy country. Again, that's the Korean Peninsula and its three kingdoms at the time. She appeared as a magnificent general. Her awesome height was 9 feet 2 inches. Her teeth are similarly large and gleaming. Skin like the sacred lotus, soft and without strength. She's more graceful than the green willow. That clothes of fine and twilled silk are still heavier than she. Weaver women must envy. So here portrayed as rather willowy, not 9 months pregnant. Yet she still wore helmet and armor, and that bow and arrow she held, she must sooner or later be taught to use. Nevertheless, she took the hair fate had given her, bundled it tongue style, which would also signify sort of a masculine hairdo. In gentle, tender hand, she held a bow. On her hip, most slender, she wore a long sword. She armed herself in tongue style golden armor. So here we have, again, a very sort of clear view of her, in armor, particularly splendid height and bearing, and yet still described as, again, rather willowy and thin, as being, quite gentle, picking up this armor and weaponry out of necessity. So here again, if you didn't know, you wouldn't think that she was pregnant from this particular passage. But if we look at immediately the next passage, we do get a sense of this, as it was her month of giving birth and her august breasts were therefore enlarged, the chessboard of her armor was made higher. Since it was then open to attack, Kora Daimyojin, an assisting deity, cut the tassets and attached them under her armpit. What are now called wakidate come from this and are linked to all armor. So here, even though again, she's described as being, so thin and so feminine, need we say, she's also putting on armor. Her armor has to be adjusted because of her pregnancy, and some of those adjustments have irrevocably changed armor, or so the text claims. We also see that there's an emphasis on sort of the power of her women's body and her ability to overcome it. Much later on in the text, it says that the empress, by means of an intestinal force and her woman's body, won over and conquered the three great kingdoms of Shilla, Baekje, and Koguryo without the passing of many days nor the turning of many hours. If the empress had thought, "I am just a woman," and had not taken up bow and arrow, the whole country would have been taken by the foreign enemy and Japan would have been destroyed all at once. So here there's a clear credit to the empress sort of overcoming the supposed limitations of her woman's body and accomplishing the conquest in its spite. There's also an emphasis on her role. Here, there is no mention of Hachiman or the child in her womb. There's plenty of that mentioned in the text, but there is at least some attempt here to credit the empress for, sort of taking on the task in spite of her woman's body. In another portion of the Hachiman Gudokun, it's divided into two halves. The Kō text is the more narrative one. The Otsu text, written slightly earlier, has, sort of a bunch of different categories. And within the discussion of pollution, there's this interesting bit that also speaks to Jingū as having a very clearly female body. At the Kashi Shrine, another shrine dedicated to Jingū, her husband and her son, when the time of the Holy Mother, which refers to Empress Jingū's menstruation, comes, she makes a separate hall known as the defilement hut. Divinity though she may be, she nonetheless respects pollution. Shall ordinary humans then not humbly do the same? So again, this is a really interesting passage that suggests that kami also menstruate, and that when Jingū menstruates, she follows the correct protocol in terms of separating herself from others. Yet we also find that in many texts having to do with Hachiman's, also a discussion of Jingū taking on a male guise or the appearance of a male. The exact character used for that sort of appearance or guise changes, but it's something that we see from very early on. Indeed, in the Nihon Shoki, there's a passage about her saying, "Although I am a woman and a feeble woman at that, I will borrow the outward appearance of a man." And this in some way, again, leads to her then taking up the armor. But we see that this particular passage is kept in a lot of later texts. The Hachiman Usagu Gotakusenshu, for instance, written right around, or really compiled around the same time as the Hachiman Gudokun, also features fairly similar language in terms of both womanhood and weakness. Here, specifically, the term is unworthy or fusho, but I will temporarily take on the appearance of a man and proceed with strength and heroism. I'll be introducing several of the emaki or picture scrolls having to do with Hachiman and therefore Jingū later on, but most of them have just about the same phrase, which is that the empress suddenly took on the guise of a man and crossed over to the land of Shilla. So here it's not necessarily that Jingū is, suddenly becoming a man, although the last text, the emaki, do suggest a bit more of a magical transformation than just the adopting of a male headdress and putting on men's armor. But nonetheless, we do see a sort of ambivalence in terms of just how female and just how male Jingū is. Being 9 months pregnant, it would suggest that she's indeed quite obviously female, and thus it's perhaps the armor that helps her to disguise that in some ways as she goes into battle. So here again, we see three genderings of the Empress's body. One, she's female by descriptor, and we might even say by stereotype, right? In terms of being soft, willowy, and weak, particularly as she is going to what was considered certainly by medieval Japan as the man's realm of war. We also see her described as female by key reproductive functions, certainly pregnancy and the various aspects of it, such as enlarged breasts, but also by menstruation, which of course cannot exist in the same realm as pregnancy, but they are, you know, one needs to menstruate in order to be pregnant. But she's also given this sort of male guise, and it's often but not always related to when she puts on armor. Sometimes it's actually related to when she postpones childbirth, which is my next theme. So this is a particularly important point in the Jingū legend. But specifically when we are thinking about, you know, Jingū's embodiment, it's really crucial to look at. It is something that we see in the very earliest chronicles, both the Kojiki and the Nihon Shoki. But I'd like to again start with the Gudokun in terms of how the postponement of labor is affected. So there came a sign of the Empress's giving birth, and when she felt the constant pain in her loins, she came down off the boat at the province of Tsushima. She untied her armor and set it aside while cooling her womb with a white stone. She inserted the stone in her august skirt. If the child that I have respectfully conceived is to become the leader of Japan, then let him not leave my womb for this 1 month. So when she, you know, feels constant pain in her loins, we can assume this is labor pains. She comes out of the boat and takes off the armor that, again, she has so gloriously put on. She uses a stone to cool the womb. And this is something that we do see only starting in the medieval period, the idea that the stone is there to cool her womb. She inserts the stone in her skirt. Again, depending on the particular legend, this is described differently, but certainly if the stone is inserted in her skirt, in her loins, in her womb, we can imagine it is inserted into the vagina. In some other text, there is a clear indication that the stone is instead tied to her skirt or wrapped around her belly in some fashion, and I'll get to those shortly. And then she gives this very clear prayer that the child, pregnancy is extended by 1 month to allow her to complete the conquest and then give birth to the future emperor, the crown prince, and again, Hachiman, when she returns to Japan. So far, so good. After that, the Gudokun does something really interesting. It portrays Hachiman as replying to her from within the womb. So from inside her womb came the reply, "When the 10th month arrives, I shall regain my state of readiness for birth. Until the battle subsides, I will not be born. Proceed to the enemy country." So here again, we basically see the kami in her womb, you know, taking agency and granting that particular prayer. It's not a prayer to any other deity, but specifically to the one in her womb. Jingū basically gets really excited. She entirely forgets the battle and thought, "My son will be born soon. Now in the blink of an eye, I will see him." Filled with curiosity and wanting to hear still more of the sound, she asks repeatedly, "Say something, please," in great agitation. And I really think this particular passage is just marvelous. And I imagine those of you who have been pregnant and given birth have had the similar sort of eagerness to finally meet the child inside of you. So in a way, again, it's a sort of endearing portrayal of, you know, sort of a real interest and excitement to become a mother. Nonetheless, Hachiman essentially shuts it down. He says her son, lamenting the waste of passing time, spoke gruffly to encourage her. You must leave soon. I will not be born until the morning of your return. So again, he does speak again as requested, but really to sort of push her forward. And indeed, after that, she sort of almost miraculously finds herself back on the ship wearing armor. Whether it was indeed miraculous or she just was sort of in a haze until she found herself back where she was supposed to be, we still see this really, interesting portrayal of a, an empress asking an important deity for a boon, which is granted to her. But we also see a mother sort of getting to know her child while it is still a fetus. Again, returning to the Gotakusenshu, written more or less about the same time by another major Hachiman complex, we also have, have a slightly different version of what's going on here. When Okinagatara Shihime no Mikoto, one of the many names for Jingū, as we will see, sought to conquer Shilla and arrived in this field, her body was pregnant. And when she suddenly came to the time of birth, she took these two stones, inserted them in her honorable loins, and spoke in prayer, "We desire to subdue the western border and came here and at the point of bearing a crown prince. If this god will be born after our triumphant return, we will subdue the western border and immediately return to give birth to a virtuous man." So here too, we have a postponing of labor via two stones in this case, which I'll just say briefly may refer to the fact that later on in the medieval versions of the legend, Jingū uses two tide controlling jewels to make the tide go out, force the Korean army to come, onto the sea floor, and then uses a full tide jewel to bring the sea back and basically drown the opposing army. So it's possible that this is sort of adapted from that idea of two stones. I'll be happy to speak more about that in the Q&A if anyone is interested. But nonetheless, it does seem fairly clear here that we again have a case of insertion into the body. Turning to another key Hachiman text, the Hachiman Guji Junpaiki, the dating of this is not as well known, but it is thought to have been written sometime in the Muromachi period, although the earliest extant version is from the early Edo period. Here, another epithet for Jingū, but a particularly important one, the sacred mother, same as the holy mother we saw earlier. I used another scholar's translation, but I prefer sacred mother. And it's worth noting that the Junpaiki refers to Jingū as the sacred mother throughout the text. She disembarked for a short while at Tsushima. There's a white stone in that place. And again, here we see she uses it to cool her abdomen. And again, ask that the crown prince in her womb does not come for one more month. However, in addition to this, there's a sense of, in this record, it's also translated as in her notes, the instruction to think of her body as stone. So here we see both sort of the stone being used to, again, sort of cool the womb, stop the, as maybe a halt to the progression of labor, but also sort of a visual aid, right, to think of the body as a stone. In this case, the crown prince, Hachiman does give a reply from an oracle asking Jingū to take the stone and bind it to the cord of your skirt, or again, somehow bind it to her skirt or, indeed her womb. So we see a few different ways the stone is used in this one text. I promised emaki, and here's the beginning of it. So in the, if you're unfamiliar, there's a great project called the Hachiman Digital Hand Scroll Project, which features seven emaki from 1389 into the Edo period, but most of them are late medieval, and five out of seven do, sort of detail the childbirth scenes having to do with Jingū. So overall, they follow the Junpaiki, the text I just showed. One, sort of small addition is that most of them say that Jingū feels unwell before halting at Tsukushi, which may come from the Gudokun, the first text I showed, in which it does mention that she feels some pain before she makes a stop at Tsukushi. Here again, she cools her womb with stones. It could be a stone, it could be a plural, always the difficulty of translating Japanese texts. Similarly, she requests Hachiman to wait one more month before birth. And we find again, in some cases he replies, in some he doesn't. This is sort of the lone image of Jingū in most of these texts, which is actually after the submission scene and before after the conquest is effected, as she's actually standing in front of the three conquered Korean kings and presumably on top of their tiger rug in this scene. So it's after the postponement, but before the actual childbirth. So just to give, again, a bit of a flavor of the same scene in these emaki, the second oldest of the emaki, the Hachimangutsu Engi held at Yuraminato, the empress who was pregnant with the great Bodhisattva appeased him with these words, "I will cool my belly with stones, and if the crown prince is to become emperor, he must not be born within this 1 month." She wrote in her notes, "I must imagine my body as stone." So again, more of what we've seen before, but kind of two of the three key elements, cooling the belly with stones and imagining them as stones. We find a similar thing in two of the other engi, the one that is earlier and one that's a little later. But we also find in other engi that are generally a bit later that she again is addressing the crown prince and saying that, "Oh, young prince inside me, you are to become the ruler of the land of Japan. I ask you not to be born in the next month. If you have doubts, you must imagine my body as stones." The prince replies, "I will also sail across the sea to attack and punish the foreign lands. If I do so, it is imperative that you give birth to me on the morning you return home." So these two engi take a bit of a different approach. Certainly, there's still the sense of, imagining the body as stones and that being sort of a central thing to do. In this case, however, the reply makes it very clear that Hachiman is, basically coming with her and is an active part of the conquest, which we got a little taste of in the Gudokun. And there's also a clarification that you have to give birth to me the morning you return, basically that, he'll wait for the conquest to be complete, but no longer. Once back on Japan, he must be born. And finally, in all five of the simaki, there's kind of going back to that use of the stone almost as a talisman, that she bound the stone to the hem of her skirt and fixed it to her waist. Again, we can imagine probably against her womb in some fashion. And that not only protects the womb and allows her to postpone the labor, but in this case, turns it to stone. And here's, kind of a very slight difference in terms of wording. The three emaki that we saw earlier that don't feature Hachiman's reply also say there was no birth. Clearly, we know that he was born later, but it was said that, with the stone, with her waist, basically her womb turned to stone, there's no birth. In other texts, it said that basically this is how the birth was delayed. And I just want to briefly go back to our discussion of Jingū appearing as a man in terms of timing. In terms of both the Nihon Shoki and the Gotakusen Shu, this phrase about her being unworthy or, a feeble woman and taking on the guise of the man, that happens before she postpones later. In the Emaki, it happens after, and indeed directly after. And there's an implication that once her womb is made stone, she can basically take on a manly persona and therefore, complete her conquest. So here again, I just want to highlight that we see three uses of the stone or stones, as the case may be here. One is essentially as a medical implement in order to cool the womb. And we do have some evidence that this was a medical technique at the time, that women would use stones, sometimes already cooled stones, in order to halt the pain of childbirth or keep it from moving too fast, for instance. In terms of, we also see the stone used sort of as a visualization aid, right? Particularly when Jingū says, imagine my body as stone, as a way for, herself to basically, by power of will, hold back the birth. And finally, we see the stone also used as a talisman in order to forestall childbirth. And in this one really very clearly at Hachiman's will. In some of the texts, we see Hachiman instruct Jingū to tie the stone, to her waist, hip, abdomen, womb area in some way in order to, either sort of protect it or in some cases actually turn her body to stone. All right, now we get to the actual childbirth scene. Nothing too graphic, I promise. It is said, so again, starting with the Gudokun, it is said that within 10 days, Empress Jingū returned to her home court, way of referring to Japan, on the 14th day of the 12th month in the 9th year of Emperor Chuai. Emperor Chuai is her husband, who is dead at this point, but by some reckoning, he is still technically the emperor. On this day, the empress had a safe delivery at the childbirth hall, Uminomiya in Shikusen province, which is again now a shrine called Umi Shrine. Thus, the 16th emperor and divine luminary Ōjin appeared in this world, and awesomely, he is the one worshipped as the awe-inspiring Hachiman Bodhisattva. So again, absolutely no details as to the childbirth other than the timing and the fact that this is when Hachiman Bodhisattva, sort of officially joins the human world. Nonetheless, even though there aren't too many specifics about the birth, we actually find a lot of specifics of the legacy of the birth. For instance, the white stone that was inserted into the loins of the empress's skirt, indeed likely into her, became the divine body, basically the object that represents the kami at Okita Shrine. At the time of her labor, a branch of the pagoda tree was stood upside down, and before long, the birth occurred. That pagoda tree, which was outside childbirth hall, was used as the source material of a Buddha statue that also was employed to pray for her safe delivery. The placenta was washed into the river, and all of the fish who drank that blood became red on the lower abdomen, and this has not changed even to this day. So here we find almost more important than the birth itself is the tracing and linking the birth and various objects connected to it to, sort of key location things that remain true to this day. Here I've drawn from the earliest of the engi that are part of the Hachiman Digital Hand Scroll Project, but the language is pretty similar for all of them in this case. After the empress subdued the foreign country, she returned to Chikuzen domain on the 10th day, where they built a parturition hut thatched with cormorant feathers. Holding on to an enju, a pagoda tree, the empress gave birth. The place is now called Uminomiya, or birthing shrine. It is the present day Usa Shrine. The time of the birth of the crown prince was the hour of the tiger on the 14th day of the 12th month, the day of metal rabbit combination. Therefore, the day of the rabbit was proclaimed the temple festival day of the great bodhisattva. The 14th day of the 12th month is also referred to as the birthday gathering, and a ceremony takes place for this occasion. So yet again, we have really a very clear emphasis on, yes, this is when the birth happened. Here are a couple things associated with it. And this is, again, when the bodhisattva comes, when this particular birthday gathering that shrines continue to have, where it originates. So worth remembering that these are all origin stories, right? The, specific, origins, both large and, specific, are very important. So with the emaki, there are pictures of many things, but not a lot of them of Jingū, and certainly none of anything related to the birth, except for the birthing hut or the parturition hut. And here's an example of, again, two of the earlier emaki looking quite different, but you can see the pagoda tree as present in both of them. You can also possibly hear my cat at the moment, for which I apologize. He's just saying hi. So the importance of the birth, again, we see it in a few key ways. One, this is Hachiman's first human incarnation, as, you know, sort of calculated in these Hachiman origin stories. So this really is Hachiman's entry into the physical world. And therefore, that's what really makes it so important. Otherwise, we see actually much more attention to the postponement of childbirth scene. Again, the origin story, whether it's of sacred items like the stone or the branch of the pagoda tree, the coloring of those fish based on her placenta, the birthday gathering. And I do just want to note, I think it's really interesting that the, you know, sort of placenta being washed down the river and, you know, sort of coloring fish is seen sort of as a good thing. And this is also the time in which we find pollution taboos and thoughts of women's impurity really being quite great. So the fact that this is seen in a very different light, I think, is highly significant. So again, no description of the birth save for the pagoda tree, but what we can't really see that as being too surprising, given indeed the idea of, you know, childbirth as a, you know, polluting thing that has to happen in a separate location. So my final section, I want to talk about comparisons to other mostly pregnant mothers. So the first one worth mentioning is the lady Sharika, who is thought to be the mother of the Buddhist disciple Shariputra. And when she conceived Shariputra with clear wisdom, she recited the 18 schools. These are the 18 pre-Mahayana or Hinayana schools, attacked and forced into submission the Brahmin Diganaka. And if you, you know, find out more about this story, she didn't, you know, literally attack him, but rather debated her brother, and both of them were very learned, but she usually lost the debates. While pregnant, she won them. When this empress was pregnant with the crown prince with martial arts and valor, she led 10 million people and proceeded to do battle against the foreign enemy. So again, you wouldn't really think that, you know, beating your brother in an argument and conquering three countries would be equated. But here, really the point is that both of them do so not because of their own efficacy or intellect, but rather because they are pregnant with great men. The one that always gets me a little bit more is the comparison between Jingū and Yashodhara. Yashodhara is held to have impregnated his wife before leaving for his six-year journey and in search of enlightenment. So he, you know, forsook his pregnant empress, left home, entered the mountains. He endured penance and hardship and attained the supreme way. However, the empress constantly thought about not giving birth, as the intimacy of love is a hindrance to becoming a Buddha. After 6 years, she gave birth to the venerable Rahula. As for that, Jingū of our country extended her delivery by 1 month and gave birth only after winning the battle. Some may doubt it. Because these kind of transformed beings decide the time of their birth, both entering or leaving the womb depends on the heart of the child. So here again, we have an equation in terms of an extended pregnancy. Again, we might think 6 years is a little different from 10 months, but still, again, here the point is that it was not, you know, sort of the choice of the women themselves or even of biology, but rather transformed beings like Hachiman and Rahula, who are both suprahuman, right? They're kami bodhisattvas respectively. They decide the time. And in the case of Yashodhara, we also find that she constantly thought about not giving birth. And that was the way that she postponed labor. It was more of a mental exercise, not so different from the various mental exercises her husband was going through in order to become the Buddha. Finally, there's a really intriguing comparison between Jingū and who I'm calling, for lack of a better word, Hanshara's queen, where the breast milk in particular plays a key role. So it is said within the text, this is the Gudokun, that Jingū's conquest of a neighboring country by a woman was unheard of in either Japan or China, but there is a precedent in India for this. Hanshara, which is the Japanese reading of three characters representing Pankala, gives birth to 500 eggs. Not such a good thing. Thinking this shameful, the eggs were placed in a box and slid into the flow of the hidden, another term for the Ganges. The neighboring king, who was the enemy of Hanshara, opens the box to find not 500 eggs, but 500 boys. The boys grew into gallant soldiers, and once of sufficient age, they are dispatched to attack Hanshara and his kingdom. Hanshara's queen then tells the 500 that they are in fact her children. In my breast, there is milk for 500. Open your mouths. When my breasts are squeezed, the mouths of 500 men will at once be filled. This is because I am the mother of you 500 men. This is accomplished. The children embrace their parents and the war is halted. So this is described as being akin to Jingū's conquest of the Korean peninsula while pregnant. This is quite a long passage, and thus I've given you sort of the Cliff Notes or the M Notes version here. But this is a story that I think likely is adapted from various aspects of the Mahabharata. It's also featured in the Konjaku Monogatari, which has a series of tales from India. I think it's a conflation of a few different stories from the Mahabharata, but clearly here there's a sense that a woman who gave birth in a very sort of unorthodox way nonetheless was able to halt, shall we say, the advance of an attacking enemy. And it's worth noting that within many of these medieval Hachiman texts, there is a sense that Jingū is going to conquer Korea in order to keep Korea from conquering Japan. So there is a sense of holding off a threat from a foreign country, as both Jingū and Hanshara's queen are able to do. Finally, I want to bring in one more sort of contrast, and this is one that appears in the emaki and not in the earlier text. So this features Empress Shotoku, who is the last of the early reigning female empresses in Japan. This two going to shorten version. First, Emperor Shotoku denies that women's karma is greater than men in various sutras. So she states specifically that even though my body is female, I'm not affected by these matters. So not that this isn't true of females, but that they don't affect her. Nonetheless, she burns the sutra and is immediately consumed by lust. Huge problem. What does she do? Send out for someone to help fix the problem. And the monk Dokyo, who in reality was a healer and did help the Empress Shotoku overcome some of her illnesses. So basically, Dokyo helps her out in various ways, shall I say. And in return, Shotoku seeks to make him the emperor with Hachiman's approval, which she seeks to solicit. Her messenger, Wakino Kiyomaro, questions the elevation of a peasant to the throne. Empress Shotoku forces him to go ask Hachiman anyway. Hachiman denies it. And when Kiyomaro brings back Hachiman's disapproval, Shotoku cuts off his legs. Luckily, he manages to crawl back to the realm of Hachiman, and Hachiman sends a deer who restores Kiyomaro's legs. And again, so Empress Shotoku is really portrayed as quite different from Empress Jingū. And here we really see that it's Hachiman who sort of stops her immoral behavior, shall we say. So in terms of comparing specifically Jingu's body to other key, you know, sort of Buddhist mothers on the one hand, mothers from early India, and Shotoku, who is not a mother at all, we see, you know, sort of a clear, again, focus on the body as the root of these things. So in the comparison with Sharika, there's success due to pregnancy with great men. It is, in fact, carrying the great child that allows for success success in either war or, you know, debate. With Yashodhara, she shares a prolonged pregnancy, although again, Yashodhara's is quite a lot more prolonged. With Hanshara's queen, it's really, you know, sort of the state of motherhood, whether being pregnant or having given birth to children in the case of Hanshara's queen, that halts the invading force. And finally, with Shotoku, she is, you know, sort of an interesting foil with Jingū. Clearly, you know, she has a strong relation to Hachiman's efficacy later on. But there's also a contrast in terms of the fact that Jingū is considered in many pre-modern texts to be the first ruling empress of Japan. She doesn't receive the title Tenno, except in very few texts, but she's still by many to considered to be the first empress. Shotoku is the last, at least up into the early modern period. Jingū is also thought to be, you know, moral, and in some texts she's considered to be enlightened. Shotoku, by contrast, burns sutra and is clearly very immoral. And there is also something in terms to be said in terms of Shotoku sort of not fulfilling her duty in a way by not being either a wife or a mother. Instead, she really is someone who might even be considered a traitor, since she almost made Dokyo, who is not an imperial descendant, into the emperor of Japan. So we see a lot of, you know, sort of key themes being brought up in these in these comparisons, and most of them do relate very clearly to the body. I would even say in the last case, you know, sort of the lustful body of Shotoku is clearly contrasted with Jingu's pregnant body. So what does this all mean? So pointing out some late medieval trends, there's this real interest in the practicalities of the pregnant body, in the fact that things do not fit in the same way and adjustments need to be made, in terms of labor coming at an inconvenient time, in terms of, you know, sort of the key implements needed either to calm the womb in order to address, you know, various symptoms having to do with pregnancy, and also in terms of the moment of labor itself, in terms of what needs to be there. In this case, a parturition hut, as well as this pagoda tree, which Jingū is sometimes held to have held on to. So we see a real interest that does not appear in earlier texts in terms of how the pregnant body functions, is sort of both in general and also in the midst of a particular conquest, as well as when you are pregnant, not with an ordinary child, but with a kami. There's also a clear sort of interest in reconceptualizing the postponement of labor and making it very clear what's going on, as opposed to just referring to a stone maybe being inserted, maybe being tied. These texts give a lot of reasons for why labor was postponed, and you know, why and how, basically how the stone served in a few different capacities. So again, we have the idea of visualization of the stone as a talisman and even perhaps as a medical device. We also see some precedents for the power of pregnant mothers, with the exception of Shotoku, who is not a mother at all. All of the other women to which Jingū is compared are all, you know, from an earlier time that shows that Jingū is not the first to be doing this. However, there's still a clear emphasis on Jingu's uniqueness, both in terms of her ability to accomplish the conquest in spite of her woman's body, in spite of her pregnant body, we might say, as well as, you know, this clearly also serves to aggrandize Hachiman and his particular role as being the great bodhisattva. Not surprising, these are all written by Hachiman shrines. Thinking in terms of context, why we see these particular changes, there are a few potential explanations. One is the role of the mother in the EA household, which was certainly gaining quite a lot of steam by the late medieval period as a unit of government, even as well as a family unit. And the role of both the wife and the mother was much stronger in the EA than we find in earlier patterns of marriage and familial organization in Japan. You also have key esoteric Buddhist theories of gestation and indeed of embryology, if you will, that I won't speak about a lot here. There's a lot of really exciting research being done into these. But basically, there are a few things going on. First of all, there is the sense of, sort of the 10 months gestational period and those 10 months each being mapped onto an esoteric ritual implement and having key rituals and visualizations that go alongside it. It also influenced medicinal practices at this time. And here, I think we see both some evidence of that orientation. After all, Iwashimizu was a shrine temple complex, and the temple component was a shingon or esoteric temple. At the same time, none of this relates, quite really directly to what we see in the narratives here. And thus, we do see in some ways almost an alternate vision and idea of how the embryo, how pregnancy can be imagined, if not exactly from a woman's perspective, but in terms of on the ground, as opposed to, again, from a sort of more abstract view. And I think you really have to emphasize that it's Ojin and Hachiman that is in the womb here. And therefore, we're not really seeing, at least from the Hachiman shrine complexes, we're not seeing all of this as sort of a way of aggrandizing women specifically, but really in order to emphasize the role of Hachiman, who is within the womb, who is active in some of these texts by speaking directly to Jingū, instructing her on how to postpone her pregnancy, or at least allowing it, that these are really, many of these can really be seen as techniques in order to bring Hachiman more fully into the story, which beforehand was really, Jingu's story, and he happened to be born at the end of it, or near the end, I should say. So again, by emphasizing pregnancy, they're really emphasizing Hachiman's role in the conquest. At the same time, feminists pay attention. There is some adaptation of these ideas in women's cults that we see really starting to emerge in the early modern period. This is a whole other part of my research, so I don't want to spend too much time talking about it. But just to give you a sense about how some of these textual techniques are used to actually bring a greater focus to women's experience of pregnancy. For instance, in the Awashima cult, Jingū is also deified within the Awashima cult alongside Okuni Nushi and Sukunabi Kona, who are both also, sort of healing deities. And within the Awashima cult and its narratives, Jingu's postponement of labor was held to represent women's reproductive problems, basically anything from infertility to, stillbirth and miscarriage to, just the problems associated with childbirth. And therefore, it's very clear why she became a key childbirth deity within this cult, which is particularly known even to this day for its efficacy in ensuring fertility and safe childbirth. Later, still in the Katsurame cult, the Katsurame are a group of women in Katsura, hence the name, outside of Kyoto, and they served a lot of different functions in their time, but by the Edo period, they're sort of best known as both midwives and religious specialists, and they trace their origins to Jingu's midwives, who you've noticed there really hasn't been any mention of midwives up until this time, but they figure prominently in the Katsurame's origin stories of where they come from, and they also consider their distinctive headdress, which is a white, basically a wimple, to come from Jingu's maternity sash, which again, we haven't seen very clearly, although the practice of a husband giving a wife a maternity sash and her wearing it to support her womb was very well established from early on in Japan. And we might think about whether that's at all what's going on when we're talking about the stone as a implement to being, you know, sort of tied to Jingū as a talisman to, you know, sort of turn her womb into stone or keep her from giving birth, whether that, you know, could be interpreted as a maternity sash. So on that note, I will close and thank you for your attention. I look forward to the Q&A, but I also wanted to post my email in case anyone wants to reach out and to leave you with a cute picture of my cat.
Thank you so much, Dr. Simpson, for this wonderful, thought-provoking, illuminating talk. Really, there's so much here about the body that I'm sure there will be many, many questions in our Q&A. So I'm going to let the questions roll in. And in the meantime, if you don't mind, I will ask you a question myself. So again, thank you very much for this talk. You've mentioned in your presentation that we can see that the empowerment of Jingu's body may have served to glorify Hachiman, right? So this is a little bit giving us a hint that it may have served an androcentric purpose to some extent, right? So I was wondering if in any of the texts as you've discussed today, could you tell us a little bit more about misogyny in the period and how some of these different descriptions also betray some of these negative perceptions of women? And let me add just another question, if you don't mind. You mentioned the esoteric Buddhist tropes that relate to pregnancy and the womb. And you've shown a really interesting passage about the white stone and then the following scene about the blood, right? The blood and the reddening of the fish. So this immediately reminded me what you've mentioned, right? These esoteric ideas about pregnancy. So specifically the concept of shakubyaku nitai, the two fluids, right? The red and white fluids, which are often used as potent forces, right? Talk about pregnancy and women empowerment and so forth. So I was wondering if you, what do you think is the role, does the Jingū corpus at all refer to this discourse on the two fluids? I was wondering what was your take on these matters?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, both great questions. I'll actually start with the second one first, because to my knowledge, I have not seen any direct references to either the tainaigoi, the you know, idea of the 10 months or the five phases, those sorts of esoteric ideas. I have not seen reference to in connection with Jingū, or the idea of, you know, sort of the union of the blood and the semen as being central to, you know, sort of fertilization and making children. I do wonder now that you ask, though, whether there is a sense that, you know, the white stone could perhaps be seen as akin to semen or as almost impregnating her. That would actually make a bit more sense, I think, within the context of the Sumiyoshi cult, in which Jingū and Sumiyoshi are sometimes seen as a husband and wife pair, and that even it's sometimes suggested that Sumiyoshi may have impregnated Jingū instead of Juai, her husband. So that's certainly worth thinking about, whether it could be represented that way. But, you know, I would have thought that, you know, had it been of interest, you know, again, these are clearly, you know, the people writing the, you know, various narratives, particularly at Iwashimizu, but then Usa was connected to Tendai too. So there was clearly esoteric knowledge that is not going into these narratives. So I think that might be in part a question of audience. If, you know, to a certain extent, the audience of these engi would be, you know, fellow priests would sometimes be the government authorities and such, but they do in some sense seem to be directed at an overall larger audience that maybe would just not have been familiar with these. I know that some of the, you know, esoteric ideas of embryology were also secretly passed down, you know, at this time and only became more widely known in the Edo period. So that's on that question. On the question of misogyny, it's something I could go on and on about, but I'll keep it relatively brief since I know there are some other questions. And you do see a fair amount of misogyny overall. I mean, I did highlight, you know, some passages in which Empress Jingū is credited as being solely responsible for the successful conquest. But in there are other passages, sometimes even in the same text. For instance, the Gudokun 2 has several passages that say it was really Hachiman while in the womb that made the conquest happen. So you do have that. And you know, certainly there are passages in which, again, you know, femaleness or, you know, femininity is seen as being weaker, and therefore the idea that a male guise is needed for Jingū to go into battle, for instance. Also times in, I would say a little bit more in the emaki as we get a little bit later, Jingū has a little bit less agency. Many of the decisions, you know, within the scope of the whole conquest are made by her sort of partner deities rather than by Jingū herself. But she is usually portrayed as being sort of uncommonly intelligent and as sort of being able to recognize, you know, the deities and the right course of action. So there is a degree to which I feel like she is indeed portrayed much more positively than the vast majority of women, particularly at this particular time.
Thank you. Yeah, definitely. My impression was that the depiction is much more empowering and positive than a negative one. So sorry for being the party pooper a little bit. Okay, so let's get to the Q&A. A question from Dana Mirsalis. Could you talk a little bit more about the idea of Jingū taking on the appearance of a man? You mentioned that it's unclear whether this is a physiological shift or about her gender presentation dress, but do later groups, especially women's groups, have a particular read on this? I'm thinking of the debates about the dragon girl's embodiment, but also about Amaterasu dressing as a man and going to face Susanoo, and how ideas of embodied sex were more fluid in the pre-modern period. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, thanks for that great question. I'm glad you mentioned Amaterasu because that's what immediately sprung to mind, particularly the fact that you do have Jingū bind up her hair very clearly. That's exactly what Amaterasu does before confronting Susanoo. And that is something that would have been clearly, you know, as much in the Kojiki and the Honshoki as it is in these texts, that's clearly encoded male in terms of the hairstyle of early men. You see these like particular bunches, right? And that's really what they're talking about here. So I do think there is an element to which it is, you know, sort of a, you know, connected with the battle, you know, sort of as much as it is with masculinity per se. And yeah, I can't exactly get a clear read on how clearly it would have seen that she, you know, is basically, whether she, you know, sort of assuming the outward appearance of a man while still being a woman, as opposed to completely transforming into a man. I get the sense that in most of the earlier texts, it really is sort of the outward appearance that she's going to, you know, put on armor. So she had very at the very least looks the part. She is taking over for her husband who was, you know, sort of instructed to go on this conquest, disobeyed the gods, and then was struck down because of it, at least in the Kojiki and the Nihonshoki. Many medieval versions of the legend actually rehabilitate her husband as, you know, sort of an ethical ruler who tragically died in, you know, protecting his people, and then Jingū takes over. But either way, there's a sense that she is kind of assuming his role and therefore putting on this armor. But I do think, I mean, however small it is in the emaki, you know, placing her, you know, assuming the male guise, if you will, directly after she postpones the labor. Her womb turns into stone and is therefore not a functioning womb. There is a sense that she suddenly, you know, almost does turn into a male and is a male for the duration of the conquest. I'm not sure if I'm reading too much into it, but that is sort of my interpretation based on the emaki. In terms of the sort of later uses of Jingū, certainly in terms of both Awashima and the Katsurame, I don't see any, you know, sort of indication that Jingū is male. And in fact, usually the idea of her in armor, or indeed sometimes the conquest itself, is really downplayed by this group because they're more interested in her pregnancy. Some of the texts have certainly for Awashima, have like a sentence or two on the conquest, and that's about it. And they're more focused on her postponement and troubles on the journey home, for instance. But I will note also that the ofura having to do, the talisman having to do with the Katsurame, does portray Jingū fully in armor, and most of her depictions in the early modern period, certainly as we get into Meiji period, are wearing armor. So that does remain very central to her iconography, at least.
So there, thank you. There is a related question by Just Shelton. At the time these tales were being formalized in the Hachiman Gudokun, just how uncommon would it have been to have a woman in any kind of role in war battle? I know in some samurai households, women would be trained in self-defense, but was there any precedent for women on the battlefield at that time, even if it was rare?
Yeah, thanks, Justin. Great question. So there is much, really. In fact, a lot of times I find certainly my students get really excited by the idea of women samurai and look up the term onnabugeisha. And if you look that up, you usually find Empress Jingū and Tomoe from the Tale of the Heike. So you don't have a lot of precedence for this. You start to have a little bit more, idea of this when you get to the Edo period and the Meiji period. There are, some instances where we know of, samurai women who did, sort of take up arms, but there really isn't a lot. And certainly, Jingū and Tomoe are very often, sort of held up as examples of women samurai in that fashion.
Yeah. Micah Auerbach asks, thanks for a fascinating talk. I was interested to hear about Ojin speaking to his mother while still in her womb. Is this pattern evident in other medieval or early modern stories of divine pregnancy?
Yeah, it's a great question. I've seen it primarily within the Hachiman cult, and it's something that you do only see after the Mongol invasions in the late medieval texts. It does happen in a couple of the other, does it happen in, I don't know if it happens in it, maybe the Jinpaiki, but there's another scene that's really interesting in the Rokugo Mimon Daibosatsu Hongi, that's affiliated with the Rokugo cultic site, also in Kyushu. And that you can, Alan Grippard has an excellent article about it, including a translation. But I've also written about it because in that particular scene, you have actually another deity, a sea deity who becomes prominent in the medieval versions of Jingu's legend. The sea deity Azumi no Asura, Isora, asks Jingū if he has great desire for her, and could they get together in return for his aid? And she says basically, no problem, but it is an encumbrance because I have an imperial heir in my womb. And then Hachiman responds from the womb saying that, basically, it's okay, mom, we need the conquest to happen. I don't mind. Let's do it. So that's a very, different sort of permission given here, not the postponement, but for her to basically take on a lover, and for the, baby in the womb to perhaps have some interruptions. So, in terms of whether this appears in other, sort of childbirth scenes, not that I know of, but I also wouldn't be surprised because it does seem to be in the late medieval period, you do find that the the engi, these origin stories, really are showing a bit more of a narrative and do have sort of more speaking roles than you see in earlier engi. I think it becomes a sort of important trope. So I would be surprised to not find it in a way. But then at the same time, even within the Hachiman cult, it's not like it necessarily takes over and is seen in all engi. It's still something that kind of remains a possible interpretation after we first see it in the Gudokun. Or possibly the Gotakusenshu, they're written more or less the same time.
So a question by Ruth McCreary, listening to the discussion of protracted pregnancies prior to the birth of a deity bodhisattva, I was reminded that according to Taoist myth, Lao Tzu spent 62 years in his mother's womb. Your material, is there any connection between protracted pregnancy and enhanced spiritual powers?
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's a good question. There is a passage in certainly in the Gudokun, it might also be in the Junpaiki, which is slightly later, that does mention that Lao Tzu and a couple of other Chinese figures, both Buddhist monks and I think another Taoist, are mentioned as having spent, significant time in the womb, usually a specific number of years, as you mentioned. So that is something we see, but at least in these texts, it's usually portrayed as showing how marvelous individual being born is, usually the male, not that the mother has special powers. But I think certainly in the case of Jingū, it's pretty clearly implied and even stated that, because Hachiman is in her womb, she's able to do all of this stuff, particularly, by this time when so much of the focus specifically on Hachiman. So, if you'd like to discuss more sea passages I just referenced, I'd be happy to pass them on to you and perhaps ask you some questions about the figures in question.
Question by Yadi Chu. Thank you very much for your great lecture. Can I ask about the authorship of this text? What do you think about their ideas of women's bodies? Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a great question. I didn't mention much about it, as you can see, because we generally don't know, other than the fact that if these texts are coming from particular shrines, they were most likely written by priests at those particular shrine temple complexes. In a couple of places, certainly for some of the emaki, we do have a better sense of who who either commissioned them, and in some cases we know who specifically illustrated and painted them. A couple of the emaki, for instance, were actually commissioned and granted by the shogun Ashikaga Yoshinori to Iwashimizu Shrine, Usa Shrine, and Hakozaki Shrine. Three, arguably, they're Iwashimizu and Usa are almost always considered in the top three Hachiman shrines. Hakozaki is sometimes, and sometimes it's Tsurugaoka. But in some cases we do know that, but in most cases we just have sort of a sense of what institution it's coming from and the timing, depending on whether the timing is actually, there's actually a date on the text, which there is in some cases, that's when we know they're an exact year. In others, we have more of a sense of that it was written during a certain reign or just, during a certain period. So that's one of the things that, one of the great challenges of working in the medieval period in particular. And I think, with these shrines and temples, but at the same time, we do have a sense of, what institution they're coming from and therefore what the interests of that particular institution may have been.
Next question by Robert Hoppens. Thank you for a really interesting talk. I hope this isn't too off topic, but is geography important in any of these origin stories? Are any of the Hachiman shrine or temple complexes associated with locations where major events in the Jingū story occurred, like the postponement of labor or the birth of Hachiman? Mm-hmm. For example, I think you mentioned that in town, Jingū postpones her labor while on Tsushima. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, in terms of the geographical distribution of Jingū shrines and then Hachiman shrines. In both cases, they're much more in Western Japan. Certainly Hachiman shrines are all over Japan. They are considered to be the most popular shrine after Inari shrines. And some Hachiman scholars would argue that Hachiman shrines are actually even more numerous than Inari, depending on how exactly you count them. But we do see that there are many shrines in the, you know, sort of between, you know, Nara, Kyoto area, going down into northern Kyushu and back. We see quite a lot of shrines that are directly connected to events in her, you know, conquest, because, you know, again, she is supposed to have traveled there and back. And so it gives a lot of opportunity for that. For instance, certainly, both Usa is often cited as the place where she either she gave birth, or sometimes Umi Shrine, which is in, you know, a very sort of similar area. There are also shrines that are mentioned in the legend that, you know, Jingū had trouble moving forward, whether she was going to the Korean Peninsula or coming back, and so had to pray to a deity. In most cases, the deities say, like, build me a shrine here. So that's the origin of many shrines, such as Ikuta Shrine in Kobe comes to mind. Sumiyoshi Shrine also has that sort of as its origin story. And then you find that other shrine temple complexes sort of adopt the same idea. So for instance, the Kada Awashima Shrine, the center and sort of origin point of the Awashima cult, has, you know, basically says that Jingū was blown off course on her way back and sort of ended up, you know, near Kada, and the deities there rescued her, which is, and it's only after that that she's enshrined in this shrine. But, you know, otherwise, why would she end up in Wakayama, right? It's not on the way back, really. And I even know there's a there's actually a temple, I think, in Akita that has a connection with Jingū. And it's because a monk is supposed to have dreamed that she visited, and therefore now Jingū, you know, is there in interesting ways. So we definitely do find, you know, a clear connection with geography, both in terms of where these shrines are and sort of how they extrapolate their connection to the story.
So we still have about 3 minutes. If anyone has any other question, this is the right time to ask. Going once, going twice. Okay, so Dr. Simpson, thank you so much for your talk. And thank you all for joining us this evening. And of course, very special thanks to our guest speaker for a wonderful presentation. We hope that you all enjoyed tonight's program. Tonight's lecture, along with other lectures in the series, have been recorded and will be made available for viewing on the CEAS YouTube channel. Subscribe to receive CEAS emails so that you may receive updates on this and more up-to-date information on future virtual events related to East Asia. So again, everyone, thank you for attending tonight's program and this entire lecture series. I hope you enjoyed the different talks that we had throughout the month of May. And please have a wonderful rest of the evening.